Welcome back, and in this lesson, I want to introduce AWS accounts, really understanding what an AWS account is and what benefits it provides is one of the most important things within AWS. Many students, especially at the start, confuse AWS accounts with users inside of those accounts, and I want you to be 100% clear on the difference. If you've used AWS before, you might already have an idea of what AWS accounts are and how they work. But understanding accounts at a really instinctive level is essential for a solutions architect, developer, or engineer. Simple systems which you design might operate from within a single AWS account, but more complex systems or environments operated by large enterprises might use tens or in some cases hundreds of AWS accounts. And for that reason, it's important that you really understand the features and benefits provided by AWS accounts. Now, this might seem pretty basic, but it's really powerful when you do fully understand it, and really dangerous to operate at production scale if you don't. So let's jump in and get started. Now, this is an AWS account. When you're just starting with AWS, you might only create one of these. You might even already have one. Bigger, more complex projects or businesses will generally use many AWS accounts. And in this course, you're going to use multiple AWS accounts for the demo lessons. And this will help you understand how businesses actually use AWS in the real world. At a high level, an AWS account is a container for identities and AWS resources. Identities is just the technically correct way of referring to things like users, so the things which you use to log in to systems such as AWS. So an AWS account contains users which you log in with and resources which you provision inside of that account. So keep this idea of an AWS account being a container in your mind constantly as you move through the course. But this is especially important in this stage of the course where you're going to be creating the AWS accounts that you'll use constantly as you move through the content. When you create an AWS account, you give the account a name, you need to provide a unique email address, and you also need to provide a payment method, which is generally a credit card. So if we're creating a production account, we might name the account prod for production. We would use a unique email address, which is unique for this specific AWS account, and provide a credit card for this production account. So just to reiterate, the credit card can be used for multiple AWS accounts, but the email address can't. It has to be unique. You need one unique email address for every AWS account. Now, the email address that you provide when creating the account is used to create a special type of identity within the AWS account, which is known as the account root user. So every AWS account has an account root user, so the root user of that AWS account. In this example, if you create a production AWS account, then the account root user of that account can only log in to that one production AWS account. If you make another AWS account, let's say a developer account, then that account will have its own unique account root user with its own unique email address. So those account root users are different. The production account root user can only access the production account, and the developer account root user can only access the developer account. Now, initially, the account root user is the only identity, the only user created with an AWS account. So initially, you have the blank account, the container, and inside that is the account root user of that account. Now, the account root user has full control over that one specific AWS account and any resources which are created inside it. Now, the account root user can't be restricted. It will always have full access to everything within that one AWS account which it belongs to. Now, this is the reason why we need to be really careful with the account root user, because if the username and password ever become known, the results accounts can be disastrous because the details can be used to delete everything within the AWS account. The credit card that you provide when you create the AWS account, that's set as the account payment method. So you can create resources within an AWS account, and I'll be covering these throughout the course. And if those resources have any billable usage, then that usage is billed to the account payment method, in this case, a credit card. I'll talk about this later in the course, but on the whole, AWS is what's known as a pay-as-you-consume or pay-as-you-go platform. If you use a service within an AWS account for 2 minutes, then you pay for 2 minutes of that service. Certain services include a certain allocation of free usage per month, and this is known as the free tier, and this is what we're going to take advantage of in this course to keep costs at an absolute minimum. So now that I've covered the account root user and billing within an account, now I want to touch on the security as it relates to AWS accounts. So you know that the account root user has full control over this one specific AWS account, and this can't be restricted. Well, you can create additional identities inside the AWS account, which can be restricted. I'll talk about this more soon, but this uses a service called Identity and Access Management, known as IAM. And with IAM, you can create other identities inside the account. So these can be different types of identities. We've got IAM users, IAM groups, and IAM roles. And I'll cover these in detail in the relevant section of the course. But at this point, it's important to understand that all of these IAM identities start off with no access to the AWS account, but they can all be given full or limited access rights over this one specific AWS account. So just like the account root user, the IAM service is also dedicated to your account. So unless you specify otherwise, any IAM identities created in my account won't be able to access your account. Only identities which you create inside your account and then grant access will be able to access resources within your AWS account. Now later in the course, I'll talk about how you can do cross-account permissions, but for this point in the course, just think of AWS accounts as containers. Only things within the account can access anything else within that same account. And another key thing to remember is that with the exception of the account root user, any IAM identity starts off with no permissions. You have to explicitly grant permissions to any identities managed by the IAM service. Now, another concept which I want you to be really familiar with is the boundary of the account. So on screen now, the orange line around the account, think of this as a wall. It can keep things inside the account from getting out and also keep things outside the account from getting in. AWS accounts are really good at containing any damage caused within those accounts. So things such as an inexperienced system administrator doing something silly or a bad actor attempting to intentionally harm your account. If the credentials for the account root user are leaked, then these could be used to delete everything inside that one specific AWS account. And if your entire business runs from that one single account, then this can be really, really bad. However, if you create separate AWS accounts for different uses, maybe a development account, a test account, and a production account, then you can limit the damage. If you have any credential leakage, or if you have any system admins doing any silly mistakes causing resources to be deleted, then generally these will be isolated to that one specific AWS account. You can also create AWS accounts for different teams within your business, or even different products that your business sells. AWS accounts are great for keeping bad things inside one specific part of your AWS environment. They're also really good for keeping things outside of that boundary. By default, all access to an AWS account is denied. So unless you configure otherwise, no external identity is allowed access to an AWS account. The exception to this, of course, is the account root user of that account, who always has full control. Now, this means that any external identities, for example, external users, are denied by default if they attach attempt to access your AWS account. Now, external identities can be granted access, such as Julie in the middle, if you explicitly want to allow this access. But the default security stance is that unless you explicitly allow something, then no access is allowed to your AWS account. So that's AWS accounts. They're a crucial part of the AWS product set, and understanding them at a really instinctive level is important. Whether you're a solutions architect, a developer, a sysadmin, or a DevOps engineer, you need to be comfortable with how to use AWS accounts effectively. In the following lessons, you're going to create the AWS accounts which you'll be using for the duration of this course. Now, I'm strongly recommending that you create brand new AWS accounts. Don't make the mistake of trying to use your existing AWS account or accounts, because they're likely to be in a pretty bad state. The longer an AWS account exists, the more potential there is for misconfiguration. And so it's much better to use brand new accounts for this course. I want you to learn how to configure all of this in a correct way, using best practices. So please go ahead and create brand new AWS accounts for this course. I'll even show you a trick so that you can use one email account to create all of the unique email addresses needed for these multiple accounts. So it shouldn't take that much in the way of effort. With that being said, go ahead and complete this lesson, and then when you're ready, I look forward to you joining me in the next lesson, where we're going to get started on creating the AWS accounts for this course.